An ePassport is also known as a electronic machine readable travel document, really rolls off the tongue. In short, within a passport is a contactless smart card. It's got a little copper antenna and a chip embedded in the front or the rear cover. In some passports, it's on the biographical page where your photo and your personal information is stored. And essentially, the E in the ePassport is the chip. That chip contains a digitized version of everything that's written to the biographical page. So first name, last name, whoever issued it, all of that is digitized in a particular format. It's a logical data structure is its technical name, but it's written to the chip and it's digitally signed to prevent tampering. So when you cross border, the passport can be placed on a smart card, effectively a smart card reader, a bit like an Oyster card being read or a contactless credit or debit card. And then the border inspection system can access the chip contactlessly, extract the information that's on the chip that's been digitally signed, verify the signature, and display results to the border enforcement guard. So they'll get to see the picture on the chip. They'll be able to then verify the image from the chip on their screen against the individual that's at the border gate. So they're able to do this verification. But yeah, an electronic passport is simply a contactless smart card contained within the passport booklet. From me explaining what an electronic passport is, what I've described about everything being written to the chip and digitally signed as part of what's called basic access control. And in the passport world, you have two main flavors of passport, ones which support basic access control and what's called passive authentication. And then you've got extended access control. Basic access control and passive authentication, I guess, are the majority of electronic passports that are in circulation today. So most, if not all, countries are issuing these. You can identify them by, if you look on the front cover of your passport, there's a little symbol at the bottom, two horizontal lines with a dot in the middle. That indicates you've got an electronic passport. What you're not able to tell is if you've got an extended access control or a basic access control one. But some of the larger issuers like the UK, the US and Canada, we're all issuing basic access control passports that support passive authentication. And that is anything that's on the biographical page is digitized, written to the chip and digitally signed. So when it's checked at borders, you can extract the information and verify the signature. And that's pretty much all of the electronic passports in circulation support this. There are probably one or two exceptions, but that's the bulk of the passports in circulation. The standards for that came from ICAO, the International Civil Aviation Organization. If you're going to produce an electronic passport, they produce the standards that guide you on what the chip needs to support, the format of the book, the text, the public key infrastructure that secures the information on the chip. Extended access control comes from the European Union. So an EAC passport contains everything a BAC passport contains, and the standards refer to the photograph as a primary biometric. An EAC passport contains secondary biometrics, and those are allowed to be fingerprints or retina scans, because they're the most reliable means of uniquely identifying an individual. So that's super for border control, because they can then unequivocally say, we're reading Mike's passport, there's a biometric on here, we can match it to his fingerprint or his iris scan. But because it's a contactless smart card inside the passport, if you're sat in the departure lounge, effectively anyone with a smart card reader could get access to the passport and therefore your biometrics, which introduces a privacy concern, which the European Union obviously we're not happy about. So what extended access control does, it introduces a mechanism where the chip on the passport has an application that's designed to only release the biometrics of the passport holder that are on the chip to authorized inspection systems, so your border control workstation. So the UK government can set up a public key infrastructure to issue and manage these credentials that unlock the passport for particular workstations or particular border inspection systems. It's an area that is very, very complicated. There's quite a few moving parts. And it's something that when you look at extended access control, the UK has this infrastructure which governs what its borders can do, the UK borders can do with domestic passports. So my passport, if I had biometrics on there, is controlled by the UK. But equally, the UK needs to say which other countries have access to the biometrics on the passport when we're traveling overseas. So these EAC trust infrastructures exist. Well, in an ideal world, they would exist in every single country, 250 countries plus, and each country would issue certificates to the rest of the countries to say whether or not their passport, their citizens' passports, biometrics can be accessed when traveling internationally. So we would issue certificates to the Americas to say that they could or couldn't read our biometrics, the same for France, Germany, etc., etc. So it's a very connected ecosystem that requires a lot of coordination and standardization globally. So broadly speaking, PKI provides the ability to issue digital credentials that can be electronically trusted. So you have national identity schemes that issue credentials to citizens. You have enterprise PKIs that issue digital identities to people, devices, applications, things in the office that can enable digital trust. And then you have IoT. And an IoT is really broad. That can be an industrial controller, it could be a smart meter, it could be the cell tower that's broadcasting the 4 or 5G signal to your mobile device. And then you've got electronic passport PKI. These are all different flavors of trust infrastructures. What sets them apart is size. So a national PKI and a enterprise PKI, the components are the same. So you'll have a root of trust, a root CA. You'd have an issuing CA that issues credentials to people, devices, things, or citizens. And then you have a way for those certificates to be verified. So you'd have a revocation list being published, or you'd have a server telling you which certificates are valid or invalid by way of a serial number check. At the national level, that picture is exactly the same as the enterprise level. But at the national level, we're talking millions of people, millions of citizens for a country, versus an enterprise, which is, you know, a few hundred thousand people and, you know, tens of thousands of desktop servers and workstations. So that's kind of painting one picture. Yes, it's very critical to prove the authenticity of documents and to help prove that you're able to read someone's biometric, but you're not putting a certificate on everybody's passport to prove their identity. In an ePassport PKI, for basic access control and signing of documents, it's relatively small. You've got the country signing CA, which is, in trust terms, it's very small. Well, it's a self-signed issuing CA, which is uncommon when you look at national ID and enterprise. It creates digital identities for the passport issuance system called document signers. And there's probably 10, 20, into 100 at the top end. And then you've got components that are used to exchange certificates with ICAO. So there's a centralized repository that all countries can ideally pull from. They don't all do that, but it's a centralized place where you can pull all this information from. And then you've got the border inspection workstations. And all they're doing is pulling down certificates and revocation information they need to verify a signature. They don't have certificates themselves in the BAC use case. So basic access control is a relatively small PKI compared to a national ID one. Extended access control, I guess, is similar. It has a root CA called a country verifying CA. It has an issuing CA called a document verifying CA, and the border inspection systems all get their own certificates. And then you have what's called SPOC, a single point of contact. And it's used to establish a connection with other countries so you can exchange certificates. So you can say France can read a British passport, Germany can read a British passport, et cetera, et cetera. So it's small PKI, you're talking thousands of certificates, because you think of the UK, you've got all of our land and sea borders, and some mobile inspection that goes on with the border force that, you know, is verifying people have the right to work and stuff like that. What makes EAC PKI different is because it's optimized for the chip, which is the slowest point in the entire process, there's no revocation check performed. There's no special extensions to say, oh, I can authenticate. It's all rather restricted. It's a different certificate format called ISO 7816, which means that the certificate lifetimes are really short. So if someone were to steal a border inspection workstation, that certificate can be valid for 24 hours, and then you couldn't read any passports. So the infrastructure has to issue and manage certificates at a very high rate. So that's what makes the ePassport PKI different to regular. There's smaller volumes of certificates, and in the EAC case, there's a much higher churn in certificate renewals.